Welcome, everyone, to our forum tonight on resisting mass deportation. As you may have heard today, President Trump's administration announced two more executive orders. And we'll be talking about the impact that those will have on tens of thousands of people. But here, we're not simply reacting to what's happening, but we're talking about how to strategically plan for what's happening now and what's happening in the future. As you may know, there are, in San Francisco alone, 1,500 to 1,600 people who are being detained in the federal immigration courts. 67% do not have attorneys. We are talking about a crisis of epic proportions because we do not have the legal support in place in order to address not only the current crisis, but what is to come. And we're here to talk about how to address that going forward. We're very fortunate in San Francisco that we do have a network of many legal providers and advocates who have been doing this work for years. And I'd like to begin by introducing Niloufar Kansari, who is with Pangea Legal Services, one of the nonprofits that is co-sponsoring this event with us, and one of the nonprofits that has done this work. Niloufar?
Thank you. My name is Niloufar Kansari. I'm with Pangea Legal Services, and we are part of the two networks, San Francisco Immigrant Legal Defense Collaborative and the San Francisco Immigrant Legal and Education Network, SFILDC and SF Island, who compose of 21 organizations that provide immigration services in the city. So one of the things that we know is San Francisco does provide great services for immigrants in our city and in the Bay Area. But last year we came together as nonprofit organizations and with the Public Defender's Office, and we looked at what the gap was. The single biggest gap is representation for detained immigrants. And that is an area that our city has still room to support us on and has not yet fully provided services and programs in. So together we came to the conclusion that our collaboratives would provide representation and removal defense in the non-detained court proceedings for immigrants. That is a specialty that our nonprofit organizations have and have done an excellent job in, especially in the last couple of years. And that the Public Defender's Office would provide and fill that huge, huge gap, the 1,500 people that Jeff was talking about, in representation for detained immigrants. And this is more urgent than ever now, given the directives, the executive orders, and the mass sweeping criminalization of immigrants and detentions that we are about to face. So we fully support the efforts of the public defender. We fully support the proposal put forth by Supervisor Feuer on immigrant legal defense. And we hope that you all leave today with feeling supportive and ready to take action as well. Thank you.
We very much applaud the fact that Mayor Ed Leigh and the Board of Supervisors has reaffirmed and clearly stated that San Francisco will remain a sanctuary city. But with that comes a responsibility of ensuring that our most vulnerable are protected. And a big part of that means that we have to make sure that there is legal representation behind that. And while it's important to file the lawsuits that the ACLU has filed, thank God for their work, and the city attorney, Dennis Herrera, who filed a lawsuit challenging the travel ban, we have to make sure that there is representation for individuals who are detained and for their families. So we're gonna start, we have a great panel. I can't wait to introduce you to them, but before we do that, we're going to start with a short film and video that's going to really help focus our discussions on the issues before us.
Supervisor is challenging other city leaders to stand by their promise to keep San Francisco as a sanctuary city when Donald Trump becomes president. Mr. Trump has vowed to deport 3 million illegal immigrants when he takes office in January.
In San Francisco, there are an estimated 44,000 illegal immigrants. KTVU's Tara Moriarty tells us how David Campos is now asking the city to spend millions to help undocumented immigrants who are facing deportation.
We want President-elect Donald Trump to know that there is nothing more American than immigration.
Fighting words from Supervisor David Campos, who was brought to America illegally when he was 14 years old.
It's not something that I'm ashamed of.
Now Campos wants other immigrants to feel the same way. He's asking the city to allot $5 million to help immigrants fighting deportation. The money would pay for about three dozen attorneys and other staff from the Public Defender's Office and community-based organizations.
It is a shame that there are 1,600 people in detention proceedings right now in San Francisco and thousands more around the country who don't have a right to a lawyer.
I was a detainee here in San Francisco in 2014.
Isolda Matamoros Castro fled war-torn Nicaragua with family when she was just 2 years old.
The soldiers would come and they would round up our families and they would shoot us in the head.
Castro is now raising her son, Elicio. She says she worked cleaning houses while she studied for a nursing degree. But 2 years ago, she claims one of her clients wrote her a bad check. She was sent to a detention facility on fraudulent check charges, which were ultimately dropped.
I had a suicide attempt in there, I'm not gonna lie, and I also became very sick, had several panic attacks.
Castro says she doesn't want what happened to her to happen to anyone else.
Of the individuals who are in detention do not have a lawyer in the middle of their removal proceeding. And what does it mean when you don't have a lawyer in the middle of your removal proceeding? Well, if you are, your defense to your removal proceeding is asylum and you have a lawyer, your likelihood of getting asylum is 27%. If your defense is asylum and you do not have a lawyer, it drops all the way down to 8%. So it is so important that individuals who are in removal proceedings have lawyers, and it is so impossible for them to have them if they're all being detained.
Taking out their dignity and their pride is one thing, but taking out your dreams, what's after that?
My name is Carlos Hidalgo, 46-year-old. And I've been detained in Adelanto Detention Center for 8 months. To tell you the truth, I've been in California since 1981, and I never heard of Adelanto until I was brought to Adelanto.
The process starts by being in a holding tank. There's no life to it. It just echoes, you know. And you're there with another 10, 15 people that I just have the deadest look on their eyes. And when you look at them, you see yourself. You see that how helpless you feel, how impotent you are to the system. But you don't know what's going to happen next. So they put you 5-6 hours, and by the time it's time for you to go in and take you to a dorm, usually it's like around probably 8 to 1 o'clock in the morning when they bring you in. From the psychology, you start, you know, deteriorating. And you don't want to fall asleep, but you're so tired you fall asleep. And as you wake up, it's like, who's left? Who's gone? And you see a couple of beds being made up already, rolled up, because someone was deported at night. You didn't even know. Most of us sleep through it, and it's like, next thing you know, you wake up and your bunkie could be gone. Or the next door guy, you know, could be gone. When it came to grievances, I would put hands on everything that was going on. So I would go directly to the officers, and I would confront them with every issue that was happening as far as, you know, like we're missing blankets or it's too cold, the heater, the food, anything. I would just write grievances on everything. So, but I was trying to make sure to get anyone's attention to get the matter handled. When I left, I looked back and I see this line of people lining up to, you know, come up and talk to me. I didn't realize how much I had impacted people being there, helping them out. It's sad to look back and see grown men looking at you and the only person that can help you now, and people telling you, oh, there goes our helper, and there goes our leader. And I didn't feel myself being a leader, but I felt someone that I could make an impact. But those that don't know what I know and don't speak like I do, who's gonna speak for them?
who's going to bring them to the light.
And I just focus on helping one person at a time right now.
You know, and no matter how they are and what they live and what they've done, doesn't mean they have to be singled out on a group of people that doesn't deserve to be here. This is the United States of America. This is the place where everybody dreams about making a life.
You know, I ain't going to give up on that.
His first effort was largely rejected by the courts. President Trump is launching a second round of moves aimed at coping with illegal immigration and accelerating deportations. It is both a strategic and tactical change, working within the rules as they are now written. And it is separate from a new extreme vetting executive order expected soon. Chief White House correspondent John Roberts starts us off again tonight from the North Lawn. Good evening, John.
Brad, good evening to you. Almost a month ago, President Trump signed two executive orders, one on improving border security, the other cracking down on illegal immigrants. Today, the Department of Homeland Security unveiled its plans for how it will all get done. In the election campaign, President Trump repeatedly promised he would put thousands more agents along the border and hire even more personnel to enforce immigration laws. Today, the Department of Homeland Security announced it was beefing up its forces with an additional 10,000 immigration and customs enforcement agents and another 5,000 people in the Border Patrol.
We have to have a safe country. We have to let people come in that are going to love the country.
The plan will end the Obama-era program of so-called catch and release and restore the Secure Communities program, where anyone arrested will be checked against an immigration database. Criminal illegal aliens would be prioritized for deportation. It will also enlist more local law enforcement to target illegal immigrants and begin immediate planning, design, and construction of a border wall, beginning with areas near El Paso, Texas, Tucson, Arizona, and El Centro, California, where old landing mat fence is obsolete.
Most critically, the president is empowering DHS to carry out the immigration laws currently on the books.
The ACLU immediately rejected the plan, saying, quote, "The Trump administration is willing to trample on due process, human decency, the well-being of our communities, and even protections for vulnerable children in pursuit of a hyper-aggressive mass deportation policy."
As the video stated, San Francisco's first response was to make a very clear statement, but former Supervisor David Campbell stepped forward with the legislation that provided more support for nonprofit organizations and the Public Defender's Office, and I know he's here. I'd like to acknowledge him and ask him to stand. And so this proposal is making its way through the Board of Supervisors, and you'll hear more about that from our panel in a minute. I think it is helpful, however, to understand a little bit about the historical context that brings us where we are today. If you go back in time, and these are from California in San Francisco, you'll see that the scapegoating of immigrants, particularly in difficult economic times, is nothing new, right? We see here, this is a cartoon in the newspaper which villainizes the Italian population, right? It says a nuisance to pedestrians, their sleeping apartments, and then it says the way to dispose of them, the way to arrest them. We see another advertisement here about the Irish saying that they're communists with the derogatory cartoon. We see here how people have been pitted against each other. And here they're comparing an Irish to an Anglo-Teutonic and an African-American. And again, making the case that they're undesirable because of their countries of origin. Here we have a cartoon with an Italian cartoon and a Chinese cartoon. Right, this is an ad around the time of the Chinese Exclusion Act. And remember, in every case, whether it was the Irish, the Italians, the Chinese, they were all used as cheap labor. In the case of the Chinese, to build a railroad. But when economic times became tough, the mantra became the Chinese must go. This is the Chinese Exclusion Act in 1882. And of course, we have here Angel Island, where for three decades, over a million Chinese and other Asian immigrants were kept on the island, detained in some cases for years. Right, this is in 1906 here in San Francisco, the Japanese and Korean Exclusion League, no Japs in our school. This was the Immigration Act of 1924, which outright banned Africans and Japanese, anyone from those countries, and also sought to exclude or limit the immigration of Jews from South and Eastern parts of Europe. Of course, we have the executive order 9066, 75 years ago last week. My parents and grandparents, along with 120,000 other Japanese Americans, were interned during the war without a lawyer and detained for 4 years without a trial. We have the Braceros program, where well over a million Mexican workers were recruited to work in the United States in order to harvest crops. And of course, when the economy tightened up, over a million Mexicans were deported. Half of them were citizens. If we look at the immigrant population by county in San Francisco, this is between 2008 and 2010, we see that 28% are from China, 9% from the Philippines, 9% from Mexico, and 5% from Vietnam. But the number that you should also study is a 43%, because if you look at that number, you'll find immigrants from every country across the world who are here. The undocumented population, there are a total of 44,000 in San Francisco, 11,000 from Mexico, 10,000 from China, 3,000 from Guatemala, 2,000 from Philippines, and again, 18,000 from other countries. The demographics of immigrants in San Francisco, 91% are employed. These are people that we work alongside with, that our children go to school with, that uphold San Francisco values and our commitment to diversity. Of the undocumented, 75% are living with a citizen, meaning that they have a child who is a citizen or a spouse or someone else they're living with. And 1 out of 10 workers in the state of California is undocumented. This is a, there were 4 holding centers. They're called the detention centers in California where San Francisco detainees are held. There's also the practice of shipping detainees out of state. And this is a photo of what it looks like, and it is practically indistinguishable from a prison, from a state prison. And the conditions are actually worse because often the individual does not have access to even phone calls, can't even make phone calls to family members. Of the detained immigrants, and again, we'll hear more about this through our panel, there are 1,500 to 1,600, as I mentioned, at any given time that are detained. The percent of unrepresented, that means that they do not have a lawyer, is 67%. That's about 1,000 people who have no lawyers whatsoever. Between 2008 and 2012, only 22% of non-citizens subject to an ICE detainer had a criminal conviction. That's from a national study that was done by Syracuse University. Does representation matter? This is a 2016 study that was done. It showed that detained immigrants who had a lawyer, who were represented by a lawyer, succeeded 5 times as often as their unrepresented counterparts. 5 times as often. So it makes a huge, huge difference. So now I'm very excited to introduce our esteemed panel. And They are here to talk about what's happening in this country, but more importantly, to talk about what we as San Franciscans, what we as Californians, as what we as Americans who care about these issues can do. I'm going to start here with Supervisor Sandra Feuer. She is the supervisor in District 1, newly elected. I call her Sandy, but Supervisor Feuer has served two terms on the school board. She was a parent activist and got involved with through the PTA and really empowering students, decided to run for office. She's a native San Franciscan, went to public school here, was involved in Coleman Advocate, which is a youth organization here in San Francisco, an advocacy group. And she decided to throw her hat in to run for the Board of Supervisors. And when Supervisor David Campbell's termed out, she decided to take up this legislation. I want to emphasize, you know, even though in San Francisco it's a very progressive place, it's still very difficult to take on this type of legislation because a lot of people disagree, and she's got to be the elected official to explain that. So, Sandy, thank you for being here.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thank you.
Next, a man who needs no introduction. I mean, I watched his movies from the time I was a kid, not to make you feel old, because you're not. But he's appeared in over 104 feature films, over 43 television shows and series over the years. He's a native San Franciscan. He went to Washington High School, grew up in the Fillmore, went to San Francisco State, got his training at ACT, and then he went on to his successful career. And of course, we know him through his roles as a superhero in Lethal Weapon and Witness and so many other films. But he's truly a San Francisco superhero because of the positions that he has taken over the years, and really is a civil rights icon who has weighed in on issues affecting labor, immigration, civil rights, racism, not only now, but throughout his entire career. So let's give it up for Danny Glover. Next, we have Jim Brosnahan, who is a senior partner at Morrison Foerster, one of the premier law firms in the city. And Jim, again, needs no introduction. He's the top 30, one of the top 30 lawyers in the United States. Now, you know how many lawyers we have. We have a lot. So to be the top 30, it ain't easy, and it's not easy to stay there. But Jim is here because he has long advocated for the right to counsel in immigration proceedings. This is an issue that has persisted over the years and has not been solved. There's only one state that now provides legal representation to all detained immigrants, and it's New York City. It's New York City. And so we want to be the first city on the West Coast to implement a program. So Jim is here to talk about the history. He's tried many, many cases and has taken on some of the most difficult cases of our time. And thanks for being here, Jim. And next to Jim is Judge Dana Marks. Judge Marks is the president, and she served as a president of the National Association of Immigration Judges, get this, for 7 two-year terms. That's a long time. And so she is very familiar with these issues, but more importantly, as a judge, she has tried to shine the light on, you know, what is happening and what isn't happening in immigration court. And the issue of the right to counsel is one that she has been very passionate about in leading an organization of representing the 300 immigration judges that practice in San Francisco. I was kidding her that I heard her on the radio on the way here today, and I saw her on TV yesterday, so I felt that I knew her pretty well. But she's really been on the forefront and explaining to people what's happening, and so we're glad that she's here today. Thank you. And finally, we have Beto Martinez. And Beto was detained. He was detained, and he's going to talk about his experience. And, you know, he was extremely courageous because he not only underwent detention and everything that came with that, but he's now become really a spokesperson talking about this issue, really putting himself at risk and talking about the impact that his lawyer had on him. And his partner, Eric Bernacki, is here, and we want to thank them both for being here to tell their stories. Now, Beto, I'm going to start with you, because you actually experienced what it was like to be in a detention center. Can you please share with us what that experience was like?
Well, it was pretty like depressing at first. I had no communication with anybody. I wanted to at least say goodbye to my partner because I thought that was gonna happen right away. I was there for 4 days without even wanting to eat or anything. I just stayed there, like really depressed. I only sleep because that was my only thing to do. And I asked questions to the officers inside the facility, and they couldn't answer any questions. Until like my attorney came in like 4 days after and told me like everything's gonna be okay. We're gonna fight for you and then you're gonna get out of here. And that kind of like lifted me up a little bit, but it was really depressing, yeah. So
tell us, where were you when you were detained? Where did that occur?
Oh, I was at home. We were sleeping, it was 7 o'clock in the morning.
But here in San Francisco?
Yes.
And how long had you lived in San Francisco and in the United States prior to this occurring?
Like around 12 to 13 years.
Wow. And when this occurred, did you have any notice or any idea that this was gonna happen?
Yeah, no, I didn't have any notice. I just heard a knock at the door and I opened the door and that's when it happened. No one gave me any letter, phone call, nothing.
And when they took you, did they put you in handcuffs and?
Yeah, it was kind of like a rough taking. Like they hold my hand and twist it so so they could pull me out and hold me against the wall like I was a criminal. I willingly opened the door and like talked to them without even like doing any force. I didn't think it was necessary for me to be all like pushed and handcuffs on my legs and my arms and my waist. I felt like I thought I killed somebody for a moment. I was like, when did I do this? Because I don't think I've done this before, you know? Like. Yeah.
And which facility were you taken to?
It was on, what is it called?
Samson.
I don't remember the name of it.
Samson Street?
Yeah. Well, I was taken to the Samson Street first. I was there for the whole day and part of the night. And that's when I got a chance to actually talk to him and tell him, like, I'm sorry for whatever I did. And basically, I said goodbye to him because they told me that I was being sent home. So after that, I went sent to the Contra Costa in Richmond.
Okay, and that's one of the holding facilities in Richmond, mm-hmm. Richmond County. And how long were you there?
I was there for 2 weeks. Yeah.
No, it was like a day.
Wait, what?
I think it was just like a day.
On the Contra Costa?
Yeah.
I was there for 2 weeks.
If I can add in. Yeah. Because the day that they took him, I spent the whole day trying to track him down. And it just seemed like they kept moving him. It was just like really hard. I had to like keep calling the jails to see like if he was still there because they just give you a recording. But in the same day, he went from Sampson Street to Richmond and actually went over there thinking that I could just see him and, you know, find out what's going on and such. But, you know, of course, they didn't let me see him or anything like that. And then they moved him to the other facility. Is it San Pablo?
And Martinez?
Oh, yeah, Martinez, that one. Yeah.
Okay.
And then he was there for 2 weeks.
For 2 weeks. And what information were you given about why he was taken and what was happening to him?
You know, when they took him early in the morning, I didn't even see him at all. Because, you know, he screamed for my name. And when I went to the door, there was just an ICE officer, like, blocking the entrance. And everything happened so fast, and I was just in shock that I didn't even, like, realize or comprehend what was going on. But basically, they just said that they're taking him because, basically, he's undocumented. And he has an order of removal or something like that. And, you know, they gave me a card and said, you know, call in an hour, because I wanted to know, like, where is he going, like, what's going to happen to him. And, you know, when I called, you know, they basically told me that, because I must have asked, like, is he going to get a lawyer or something like that, but they told me twice as I talked to different officers, like, you can waste your time and money on getting a lawyer, but he's going to be sent back, basically. So I just felt helpless because, I mean, this is something that, you know, you don't really think of or prepare for. I mean, here in California, we, you know, think about preparing for the next big earthquake or something like that. You don't prepare for your partner being taken away one day and planning, like, okay, what am I going to do? So, you know, I felt pretty helpless that first day. But, you know, as soon as we got help and things rolled out, you know, I'm glad that he's here now. So,
thank you. Judge Marks, I'm going to ask you just to give us, you know, a bird's eye view of what is happening, you know, in the immigration courts. We were talking earlier that there are over 500,000 cases that are pending in the court. I've heard the number in San Francisco that 36,000 cases are pending in that court. I mean, you know, we have a lot of cases.
We're up to about 39,000 at last count.
I was going to say we have a lot of cases in criminal courts, but not as many as you do. And as I mentioned earlier, 1,500 or 1,600 people subject to detention.
Okay, you'll all have to indulge my disclaimer, because it's very important that I make clear to everyone that I'm speaking today in my capacity as president of the National Association of Immigration Judges, and anything that I say does not necessarily represent the opinion of the Department of Justice, the Executive Office for Immigration Review, or any of its components. I promise now that I've done that.
Sure, that's true.
No more legalese, okay? I'm a plain speaking kind of girl. In fact, the reality is that the National Association of Immigration Judges is a labor union. And the reason why we're a labor union is because the law says that immigration judges are attorneys appointed by the Attorney General to serve as judges. And the attorney generals have traditionally decided that that means we are attorneys and we'll be treated as attorneys. And if we don't follow certain instructions, we can be found to be insubordinate and be disciplined as attorneys. We, on the other hand, believe that once you appoint us to serve as judges and once we take that solemn oath to be fair and just in our proceedings, that we need to be treated as judges, that we need to be held to a code of conduct for judges and a standard of accountability and transparency for misconduct, all in a judicial nature. So we believe that the problems in the immigration court are twofold, and then I'll go to the specific question, I remember it. We need more resources because that's been a chronic failure, but one of my colleagues said it very well. If you have a hole in your gas tank, you obviously put more gas in it when you get to the next station. But do you keep going from station to station without fixing the tank? No. Well, that's kind of what we're seeing at the immigration court today, is that there's a flawed structure which does not give transparency, does not give the judges the ability to control certain conditions of custody for people that come before us, certain ways in which cases are docketed, all of those things which we believe could be resolved with a structural reform, which would be creating an Article I immigration court. Sorry, I said I wouldn't get too legalistic on you. It basically means creating a court like the tax court or the bankruptcy court. And lawyers, I'm happy to go into all of the details and ramifications, but basically what it means is moving the Department of Justice so the boss of the judges is not the Attorney General, who is a cabinet member sibling, an equal, with the Secretary of Homeland Security. So one of the reasons why we believe the structure is flawed is the past history of treating immigration judges kind of like the legal Cinderellas. We are the disfavored stepchild in the Department of Justice who gets the leftovers. So the immigration courts for many, many years, for decades, has not had sufficient funding to be able to hear every case with the amount of attention it deserves in a timely fashion. And we believe that this is part of being a lower priority in the Department of Justice. Even now, as the executive orders are coming out, and I am reading them as soon as they hit the public press, there is barely a mention of the immigration court system in how this process is going to go along. You hear about 5,000 more Border Patrol agents are going to be hired, and 10,000 more immigration officers to help do that. You don't hear them say a specific number of immigration judges that they need. And the statute, fortunately, does require that people be afforded due process. One more brief thing, and then I'll pause. But many people get confused. I could talk for the whole 2 hours, but I won't. Many people are confused because the consequences of immigration court proceedings are so serious for people. And it's true, we often say that they are death penalty cases in a traffic court setting. Even when somebody, and it's funny, but it's true. It is absolutely accurate. It's very frustrating. Even when someone has lawful permanent resident status, ask any immigration lawyer, and there's tons out there in the audience, I'm taking notes. Permanent is a misnomer, because if someone who holds that coveted green card commits certain acts, including certain criminal acts, they can lose that right to remain in the United States. So the core thing to remember is removal proceedings are considered civil in nature, so there's no guaranteed right to appointed counsel. We can't exclude a lawyer who wants to represent someone, but that means people can only get lawyers who they can pay for themselves, or if there's the wonderful pro bono, the 21 organizations that, bless them, we need, but there's still a huge gap there. One more thing, and then I'll yield, is that immigration cases are frequently compared as being second only in complexity to tax law. And so most of you have had some experience with that, and I challenge that assertion. I believe it's more complicated than tax law. They've created a TurboTax for tax law. They have not created anything near a TurboTax for immigration law, and there's a reason for that, because when you get to the first choice you have to make, there are so many different factors that come in that even lawyers have a hard time deciding which route to take next, and often contact their colleagues to argue the pros and cons of taking those avenues. So it's very, very complicated, which is why it's so important for the fairness and efficiency of the courts, as well as for the people who come before us, to have lawyers representing these people. So thank you.
Thank you, Judge. Now, Jim, why isn't there a right to a lawyer? I mean, even in a misdemeanor case, if you're charged with a crime in San Francisco.
I think there is, and I'm not alone, and it's under the Due Process Clause. And you just heard how complex the immigration laws are. Can you take a person who has some rights because they're in the United States, or they might have been in the United States for a long time, they might have family, they might be grandparents, they might be parents, they might have children here. Can you take them without a lawyer and put them through a process and then put them on a bus, which is what we're talking about, and take them to Tijuana and drop them off? Probably where they know nobody. If they speak the language, that helps. If they don't speak the language, then that's a double problem. Can the U.S. courts do that? And the answer to that, I think, is no. And there's a terrible case in 1981 called Lassiter, in which a mother could be deprived of total contact with her child without a lawyer, even though the other side had a lawyer. And that's a terrible burger court case. By way of background, my view of this is I think this is a battle for the soul of America. I would just as soon be here tonight with you as anywhere. And there are groups all over the United States. This afternoon in Arkansas, Senator Cotton had a group. And when a woman got up and said, this is all in violation of the Constitution, she got a tremendous ovation. The people are out there, whether they're documented or undocumented. I'll keep this very short, Jeff. I had a client who was 29 years old, a U.S. citizen with the mental age of about the second grade. Born and raised in Hawthorne, went to school there for a while. They took him, put him on a bus, and dumped him in Tijuana, okay? He was there for 3 months. He had a mental breakdown. His mother, who he lived with his mother for obvious reasons, went to Tijuana and looked in all the morgues to see if she could find the body of her son. When I hear the president say that this is going to be humane, I mark down yet another deception on the American people. My view of the Immigration Service, I was a federal prosecutor for 5 years, it is the worst group of any of them. It is the least disciplined. They do things, as I'm sure many of you know, which are inconsistent with the teachings of Jesus Christ. And sometimes when I mention in debates Jesus Christ, I get criticized because Democrats are not supposed to mention Jesus Christ. It's just, as I understand it, it's only the Republicans who are supposed to mention Jesus Christ. Where are we? These orders, which I read, which empower an agent to pick somebody up if the agent suspects they have committed any crime, if the agent suspects they have done that, to the point. There's 180,000 lawyers in the state of California. Many of them are doing what they can already. The need will be tremendous. I've seen this before. Sometimes it will happen that things change so dramatically and so suddenly that all of us are trying to figure out what to do. The nonprofits have had a certain existence, and in San Francisco, they do wonderful things. That's all changed. That has totally changed. I mean, I was alive on December 7th, 1940. It's all different. They're coming. They're going to do terrible things. My granddaughter's in the eighth grade at St. John's Catholic School, and she and I have talked. She is worried they're going to come and take her friends away in a van. To say that we're for sanctuary is important, but it's not going to be easy. This order specifically provides no money for the city of San Francisco except for law enforcement. This order provides all kinds of draconian steps to be taken, expedited hearings, hearings in front of immigration officers and so forth, all of that. Innocent people will be caught up in this net. This has happened before. It's happened to the Japanese. It is not unusual. It is not different as to what is happening here. These are our people. Who's going to pick the grapes? Who's going to pick the avocados? I was talking to a grape lady today over in Marin. They are in 1 in 10 jobs. What's going to happen to the economy? And I close with this concept that nobody seems to want to say out loud, and you may think it's inappropriate. The man who made this happen has rather serious mental issues. I will stop talking, but the lawyers back for 2,400 years have spoken truth to power. And in that sense, forgive me, this is a great time to be a lawyer. This is it.
Thank you. Now, Danny, you've traveled all over the country, all over the world, and yet as a native San Franciscan, you know our city, you know our history, our tradition. At, you know, in 1860, half of the citizens of the city were immigrants. What do you see in the context of everything that's happening around the city, and particularly the villainization of immigrants? You know, what role has race played in that? And how can we as a city come together and help lead this nation through this dark time?
I want to thank really all of you for being here, and certainly I want to thank everyone on this this panel. Jim's remarks were really telling truth, speaking truth. This is a very frightening moment when a former mayor could say that Black Lives Matter is a terrorist organization. You can get a sense of what is happening in this country. But we go back to 1994 and Proposition 187, which I was involved in working to fight against, the demonization of children, the removal of a vital and important subsidies for children in schools. And what happened was, even 20 years ago, young kids, young students walked out of their class facing the prospect that Jim's granddaughter faced, that those kids would be rounded up, or those kids would be excluded from having certain care and necessary care and as citizens, as human beings. It's a remarkable time. When I thought about coming to this panel, I thought about my engagement. I'm born and raised in San Francisco more than 70 years ago. From my earliest friends were young boys and children who were my age, whose parents had come from somewhere else, whether it was Mexico, or whether they were Chinese, or whether they're Japanese, whether they were Middle Eastern Europe. I remember Middle Eastern Europeans. I remember one of my best friends in the seventh grade. Mother did not even speak English. Grandmother, who was raising him, did not even speak English and everything. I've witnessed and I worked for the Model Cities Program in San Francisco from 1971 through for 6.5 years. And I remember how vibrant the mission was. But it was vibrant because there were support systems for men and women from Central America and Mexico to acclimate themselves to this new environment. Their language connected them, of course. I was evaluation specialist and program manager for one of the 25 best reading programs in the country in 1973 and 1974, the Mission Reading Clinic, and how powerful these communities came together in the service of not only themselves, but the service of the cities. And I've watched this in such a way as I look at an unfortunate situation that we're in, that race does matter, whether we're Hispanic, whether we're Asian, whether we're Black. And this is very troubling. But what we do at this moment will characterize who we can and should be. This is the civil rights, human rights issue of the 21st century right in this country. And as Jim says, it is right there, this moment, the battle for the soul of this country. So I think what we do in every way we can, embrace it. And it means, whenever we've embraced it, it's like the abolitionists. in the 19th century who harbored slaves. It was like those who ran the Underground Railroad, who was all those people and everything who demanded in so many different ways, and we know the list of them. In the same way, they were calling on us and calling on our morality at this particular point. This is our battle right now. San Francisco is always right at there, been the epic center and the place where people stood up for justice and stood up for human dignity and human rights. Always been historically. You know, immigrants came here, they worked on the docks. Irish immigrants, Australian immigrants, people came here, worked on the docks. They worked in all capacities. All of us who were, and some of us who are old enough, remember the great boycotts and remember the support that we gave to the small union that was developing, the United Farm Workers. We know that. We have a history of that. We have a legacy of that. That's part of our DNA. We need to use that. We need to do everything in our power and beyond what we our power, beyond what we've done before at this critical moment. And the question, the real question and the real underwriting is, how do we resist? How do we resist at this moment?
Thank you. Now, Sandy, as Supervisor Fuhrer, as a new supervisor, how much of a challenge is it to bring legislation such as this at a time when the country does seem divided? And I'm sure that even in progressive San Francisco, you have to answer questions from constituents about, you know, and I'm also curious to know what motivated you to stand up for undocumented individuals, non-citizens, at a time when they're being attacked?
So I'm just gonna say that as I'm listening to the panelists, I'm trying to keep it together because actually this issue is really personal to me. So I am a fourth generation San Franciscan, and my grandparents came here on falsified papers. And so my grandmother spent a month at Angel Island, actually trying to recall all the lies that she was supposed to remember so she could be let into this country. And so I stand before you today, or sit before you today, actually, as a you know, a granddaughter of someone actually who is a limb but bought Leigh papers. And so my raised as actually a Leigh, but really family name was a limb. So we understand that immigration, our immigration policies in the United States are inherently racist, and they've been racist for a very, very long time. And so, but I think more than that is that I have three children, and my youngest is 25. And when he went away to college, my daughter said to me, "Mom, would you and Dad consider hosting a student in your home for a year?" She is the first in her family to graduate from high school. She came from Mexico City. She's done 3 years of high school in East LA, and she got accepted to San Francisco State. But the housing is $1,200 a month. My husband was a police officer at that time. He's retired now. I was elected official. We didn't speak any Spanish at all. And we said, okay, we'll try it for a year. And Yadira came to live with us for 4 years. And actually, I consider Yadira one of my children. And her family and I have really bonded, and our families have bonded. But I thought I knew immigration, and I thought I knew about the lives of people because I had worked at Coleman Advocates for so many years, and many of the parents that I organized were undocumented. But it wasn't until Yadira came to live with us that I really understood how it impacts undocumented people on a daily basis, and how they are fearful on a daily basis, and how brave it was actually for her to come live with us, knowing that my husband is a San Francisco police officer too, as someone who actually their whole family feared, and had never even really spoken to a police officer. So for her to come and live with us was a really a brave thing to do, but really much braver things she had done before she even got to us. Crossing the border, the things that she and her family suffered in Mexico. I gained a really deep understanding, not only a deep love for her and her family, but really a deep understanding about how unjust this whole thing is, how unfair it is. And as I'm hearing the panelists speak, today I had another really emotional moment at the Board of Supervisors, where in the Rules Committee, Public Safety Committee, we said we will not adhere to a Muslim registry because we are San Franciscans and we stand strong against a Muslim registry. Yes. And when we hear the testimony of Muslim Americans coming to testify before us, saying thank you, thank you, thank you for doing this. We love this country. Thank you so much. All I could feel was profound shame and embarrassment to sit before them as an elected official with the privilege of being an American citizen here. I was so deeply ashamed and embarrassed about what our country is doing and what we are doing, and also the lack of what we are doing. So today, I am happy to share with you, and I am so proud, actually, to carry the legislation of our esteemed supervisor, David Campos, that had the vision of what could happen when a person like Donald Trump becomes the most powerful man in the world, not just the most powerful man in this country, but in the world. So I think it's really important why San Francisco, and it's important because of what everyone said, is because we lead the nation. San Francisco is not important just to San Franciscans. San Francisco is important to California. San Francisco is important to the rest of the United States. And San Francisco now is so important to the rest of the world. And what we do here, I have to admit, sometimes they think we're crazy, but then they follow because we're right. And we should. And so we should be leading this on the West Coast. It is what we do as San Franciscans. So in San Francisco, we have a legacy here. We have a legacy that we actually, excuse my language, but we give a shit. We care about people. We care about, we're foodies here. We care about getting the best food, but we care about the people who make our food. We care that your children are safe, that they have education. We care that they have health care. We care about the people here who serve us, who live among us, who we consider San Francisco family. And so I just can't even believe that it's been such a struggle, Jeff knows this, that it's such a struggle to get this funding to have representation for people who are detained. And you saw a picture of what those detention centers are look like. They are prisons. And these people, I don't know if the public defender mentioned, but two-thirds of these people do not even have a criminal record. They are just picked up. And I think this is going to, it is going to get worse. I think we're going to see many more people in our immigration court in San Francisco. I think they are going to be hauling people out of their beds and out of their homes, just as they did right here with this couple here. I feel like this could happen at any moment. Am I fearful? I am completely fearful. But I know the world is counting on us. And so this is our fight here in San Francisco. We should be doing this on the West Coast. If New York is leading in on the East Coast, San Francisco, this is the time. If you believe in human rights, if you believe in civil rights, then you must believe in due process rights, because that is what protects all those rights. And for those people, those 1,500 people, 67% of them, that do not have representation, we know from our budget analyst report that if they have representation, they're 7 times more likely to be successful. And so how can we as a society deny them that? You know, it is a funny thing at the Board of Supervisors, and I'm new there, and I don't kind of really know what's going on, I'm going to be honest with you. And a couple of weeks ago, we voted to approve a $32 million parking lot. And I'm talking to other supervisors, and they go, well, that's for research. That's a parking lot. And I look at them, and I say, these are human lives. These are people who are the breadwinners of your U.S.-born children. And you are taking them out of their homes without any representation. I don't care about a $32 million parking lot. I care about those people who can't even find their loved ones because they've been shipped to here, to there, to here. And also, if you're detained, it is so hard for you to to mount a case in your own defense because you are actually incarcerated. And so how do we do this without funds? How do we do it for help people who have limited ability to understand this complicated immigration law? What can we do for them? We can do something that is very, very simple. We can fund public defenders who actually have this expertise to represent them. When these people are at their lowest point, when they are detained and you saw them, this is incarceration completely. And another fear I have is that, you know, it's funny, I was in front of City Hall and I gave some speech and I said, you know, this is what happens when we elect a psycho person to be our president. And then I was on Fox News, it was crazy. Then all of a sudden, I was on the news saying that, and people are saying, can you imagine working for her? You know, but this is what happens when we do elect a psycho person. I feel that we have to be prepared, and we have to be ready. And for all those people, those 1,500 people that are detained, we need to be able to tell them, help is on the way. We are there. It is not enough to say we stand shoulder to shoulder with our immigrant communities and let them languish in these prisons. And also, not only that, but I am just fearful that this is where our cycle president will go first. He will go to these detention centers because they know he knows they do not have representation, because he knows that they don't know what's going on and they don't understand the process and they don't have access to due process. This is such an easy way for him to sweep up thousands of people and overnight and put them on buses, because you're right, that is exactly what they do. They put them in vans and then they just go across the border and then they're stuck there and they don't have any money, they have no resources, they don't even have the ability to call home and tell their loved ones where they are. And that is just what is happening. And I think even as we speak, even as we are debating this at the Board of Supervisors in San Francisco, that there are people going through immigration court every day. It is more than just Yadira who came to live with us. I was on the school board. You know, we serve so many children whose parents are undocumented, and the fear that they have to bring them to school. They don't even bring them to school. They're so fearful. The day after Trump was elected, children didn't come to school. They thought they would be taken away. I turned 60 next week, and you know, I was pretty complacent, I have to say. You know, women's right to choose, hey, we got it, you know. I thought all these, that were Sanctuary City, were here in San Francisco, were safe. I was complacent and completely guilty. I am not complacent anymore. And I am asking all of you not to be complacent anymore. We must fight for this. And if you ever thought that you might lose your human rights, your civil rights, your right to free speech, your right to your own reproductive destiny or whatever, this is the time. This is the time. The world is calling on us. And through San Francisco, this simple legislation. This is not a $32 million parking lot. This is a small amount of money in comparison to the human lives that it impacts and what we can do. I know that we are all reeling from what is happening because we're being attacked on different levels, but this is something as San Franciscans that we can do. This is something as San Franciscans that we should do. And most of all, this is something as San Franciscans we must do. So this is going to be debated in about 2 weeks at the Board of Supervisors. We will hit it again, and we will work very hard again. And I ask all of you, if you are interested, write letters to the Board of Supervisors, urge them, write letters to our mayor, let him know that thank you, Mr. Mayor, for standing up at the State of the City address and saying firmly, we stand shoulder to shoulder with our immigrant community, but we needed to take it a step further. And we need to offer and make sure that these people that are detained have legal representation at this time in their lives when they need it the most. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. want to go to Jim, but I'll go to Beto first. I wanted to know, you were in custody for 2 weeks in Richmond County, Richmond, California, in the holding facility there. Were you able to get a lawyer to help you, and how did that happen?
Like I said before, the first 4 days, like, I wasn't communicated. I didn't have any communication with my partner or anybody until my lawyer came and he introduced himself, and I never met him before at this point. And when he came, he introduced himself, and he told me, like, is it okay if I represent you? So I was like, I don't know you. I was expecting another lawyer, which it was a female, because that's what I thought. That's the person I applied for the U visa at first, and I thought she was gonna come and see me. But when he came, I didn't know if I should trust him. I didn't know who he was. I was all, like, confused, and it turned out to be, like, the best choice I ever met, I ever did. Sorry.
And what support was your lawyer able to provide you?
Well, he advised me on just what to do in there. Like, he told me, like, I've been in communication with Eric, and he told me that I needed to just, like, hold on for a minute and make sure that, like, I don't sign any papers, first of all, and I don't talk without him, with anybody. And he told me that there will be a time, and then there will be either a long time or, like, a short time that I will stay there, but, like, he's gonna try to get me out as soon as he could. So that was the first steps. And then after that, he told me that I was gonna go on an interview with the immigration officer, which he applied for asylum for me, and then we went through that process. I'm sorry, I'm recalling all this, and it was pretty intense. It was pretty intense, the whole, like, situation. So I went to the interview with the immigration officer. Right after that, a week after that, I got released because he went public with my case. He went up with the media. They have conferences, and they told me, sorry,
and a protest
as well. So the same day the protest happened, I got released from custody, because he actually did all this process and advised me correctly, and I told me, like, let's do this, and it's gonna help your case, and it did. I got released, like, the same day that the protest happened. He was speaking on the protest. My lawyer was speaking at the protest, and yeah.
How long did the whole process take?
Right after I met him, the process started, and it was like a week and a half, pretty much.
And is your lawyer here?
Yes, and he's right over there.
And who is he?
Francisco Ugarte. Okay,
before we continue, I want to just point out, if you have any questions, we're going to open it up for question for the panel. So just fill out one of these cards, and there's people walking around. You can raise your hand. Jim, I know you had something to add.
I just want to speak in support of the supervisor's bill for this reason. I've never understood how a court could have an unrepresented person on a serious matter and proceed. And the logic of it, to me, is quite obvious. You go to law school for 3 years. You study procedure. You study evidence. You learn how to make an objection to bad evidence. You learn a little bit about how to gather evidence, how to present it. You learn about appeals. You learn about writs. You might learn about how at least to approach asylum. There's a wonderful lawyer standing over there who just was acknowledged. He knows about asylum. There are people in the hall that know about asylum. They know that's a law. The president didn't know that when he set the order. He set an order that the Ninth Circuit looked and said, whoa, this excludes people from asylum, contrary to law in America, and then he attacked the court. So there's the lawyer who understands that. Then if the lawyer has practiced a little bit, they've understand how to deal with judges, which is basically, yes, Your Honor, all right? Yes, yes, Your Honor, okay?
Your Honor, you're and, right, Your
okay.
Honor.
And now, this bill proposes that there be experts who know what they're doing and volunteers who can be assisted. There are enough fascinating legal issues in these orders that came out yesterday. It would cross a rabbi's eyes, all right? There is void for vagueness. There is the question of legal statutes. Who's going to get into all that if 70% are unrepresented? I'll close with this. A 9-year-old girl stood in front of an immigration court probably a year ago now in California, I think, spoke no English, and it was the question of whether she'd be deported. That was too much for the governor, and it was too much for the legislature, and they voted for money to handle those cases. I have not understood why California is behind New York. The Chief Justice in New York has gone and gotten many millions of dollars. And so the supervisors who are here, and they mean well, and some of them practice law and they understand it, but it's a disgrace to have a person whose future is being determined not have a lawyer standing beside them. So that bill sounds awfully good to me.
Thank you.
Now, Judge Marks, not to put you on the spot, but how does that work when you have so many people coming into court who don't have lawyers? I mean, what does that look like? I mean, you have a government lawyer representing the government's
That's
position.
That's correct. There's a government lawyer, and in a lot of ways, immigration court is like the kind of court you see on TV. Some of the formal rules are relaxed in immigration court. So there isn't, you hear people talking about discovery, that kind of complexity doesn't come up. The traditional formal rules of evidence don't apply. It's very challenging for immigration judges because on one hand, we have to make sure that we remain neutral and impartial. That's our job. And I'm here today not to take a political position on anything, but just to try to explain how it fits into our structure in the same way. And yet we also have the responsibility by statute to elicit information and make sure that if someone has a potential benefit under the immigration law, that we figure that out and help explain to them without appearing to be biased or prejudging the case or in their favor or putting the finger on the scale in on their behalf. We have to try to figure out and make sure they know what their possible benefits are. And it's very difficult to juggle both those tasks.
I mean, because you're the one that has to decide what's going to happen.
Well,
and at the same time, you have to help the person figure out what their defense is or whether they have asylum. But you know, you don't really have the resources to investigate these cases and to bring the facts before you.
Exactly. There's no investigation. We deal with the record that's presented in front of us. And so you hear about similar cases, one winning and one losing, and you wonder why. Well, it could be because the evidence wasn't presented to one judge, and it was presented in another case, because the judge has to make their decision based on the record that they have. It's actually a cost savings for the process. It means that cases can go through more quickly. How can someone who is detained get the documentation that may be available from their home country? That's very, very difficult. How can someone even write their own statement if they don't speak English well, and yet the court requires that they present their application in English? So if not, what's going to happen is the judge is going to spend their time being the legal clerk of writing out the application with them in court, spending that precious court time to do it. So it's in the interests of economics that lawyers do these things out of court. So overall, I believe it's a cost savings to the system, because then the government is not paying to detain these people, and the court proceedings can go much more quickly when someone does have an advocate who can help them in that way. So it's very helpful from an efficiency point of view and from a fairness point of view that the judges can be more comfortable sitting back and not taking as active a role, which leads us open to challenge by the DHS. If I appear to be helping someone too much, the DHS, who has a prosecuting attorney there, has every right to question whether Judge Marks is being objective in that case. And yet I'm trying to balance the duty that I have under the statute as well to make sure that I don't leave any stone unturned. When I can rely on an attorney to do that, then I can sit back and play the more traditional judicial role, which I think is most appropriate. If not, we have to pick up the slack and fill that gap, and it's difficult to do that while remaining impartial. Hmm. But we're getting good at it.
Thank you. Danny, I mean, you know, there, as I mentioned earlier, one of the strategies has been, particularly when it comes to people of color, that there's a divide and conquer, that, you know, using resources for one group means less resources for another. Or certainly, you know, we're seeing that the scapegoating of immigrants, is saying that, well, the reason you don't have a job is because there are undocumented people in this country who are taking your jobs, or the jobs are being shipped out overseas. How do we keep people united and engaged in what's happening? I mean, there's so much that's you know, being thrown out every day, that it, you know, it's almost a numbing effect. Yet at the same time, you know, we see so many people standing up now. Then I know I've experienced in my lifetime. I know you were around during the civil rights era, but talk to us about, you know, what we can do in order to get people engaged in these issues, and that these do not become wedge issues, as I think the Trump administration hopes.
Well, I think we might be at a point where, because everything that's happening with us in this country, that we may find more engaged citizens, and I use the word citizens, engaged citizens, and not only are they engaged, that they're sustaining that engagement beyond their particular, but their specific issues itself. I remember with the passage of 187, and unfortunately, that the African American community were targeted and were the ones who voted surprisingly. And surprisingly voted yes on 187. And with all our tradition and all the struggles that we've encountered here, it's very disappointing in that sense. So there has to be, and I think what's important is a new sense of ourselves and our relationship to others. And you would think that in California, that would be a very something that's acceptable and can be nurtured, and I think on so many levels, I think we're going to have to introduce ourselves and be involved in the body politics a great deal more, wherever we are. We have to find those kind of alliances, you know, and building the kind of network and the relationships necessary to understand that we're here in the same boat. We hear and have to have some sort of empathy to the stories that come to us, the stories that we hear right at this particular table, the stories and then the painful stories. We have to find somewhere that we have to develop that kind of character or reassert ourselves in that time, with that kind of character. And I think on the way how we, me as an artist, me as a and not simply an artist, I don't abdicate my responsibility because I'm an artist and visible, and my responsibility as a citizen, we have to begin to find ways of creating the stories and connecting the stories and continue to connect the stories and build our own consensus and build our own history. That happens in the public space. There are legal experts sitting here could talk to you about what we can do, how we can do it from the legal standpoint in the courtroom. And as immigrants are picked up and as immigrants are held in detention and everything else, but what we do in reinitiating or reigniting our own imagination of our possibility here as citizens is the key to that. Whatever they're capable of doing, lawyers, judges, whatever they're capable of doing, is it cannot be sustained unless we do that. We have to take this position. And it's happening in all movements. This is a movement. We have to think about this being a movement in the movement category. We have to think about ourselves building a movement, a sustainable movement. We have to elect those officials, wherever they are, locally, regionally, statewide, everything else, who are going to support that. And we have to take it really out of the, just simply out of California. As we've witnessed, the stories find themselves in other places in this country as well. And other people have begun to question the choices. Yeah, we have to question the choices. And I found this in the sense of the labor. I'm working on a campaign around workers, auto workers in Mississippi. Now, in Mississippi, Nissan workers who don't have the right to vote, to have a union, and Nissan has used all kind of fear tactics, obstructing their ability to organize, all those things. And certainly, workers have the right to vote, have the right to organize. They don't have to deal with the suppression that we've had because they're on the laws, their books that give them right to organize, even in a right to work state. But on the one hand, at the same time, these same workers who voted in favor of unions, who voted in favor of defeating legislation by the governor of Mississippi that would further handicap workers from organizing union, at the same time, some of those workers voted for Trump. The numbers by the UAW of workers who voted for Trump, even though the UAW, United Auto Workers, supported Hillary Clinton, the numbers are appalling. They increased the numbers of those who voted for Trump. And in those battleground states, those great states like Michigan, or just states like Pennsylvania, and other states like that. So there is, we have to take, since the issue around immigration is driven primarily by fear, we have to find ways in which we are able to shape that fear, take that fear, and shape it into building a lasting relationship. And I don't know if the question is that in mass movements, in movements outside of the places where we are now and the establishment of resistance, the way in which Californians have done, I'm afraid that this is going to be our main challenge. I'm afraid that, can we meet the challenge right now? Can we meet this challenge? Not only in this city, right now here for us sitting in the audience, you know, yeah, we're preaching to the choir here, you know, but we have to preach to the choir, as Dr. King said, because they may stop singing. So we have to start to preach to the choir. But where do we go outside of the choir? Where do we go to those people and change their hearts and change their mind? But that's what it is. There's a relationship, even with all the movements, from civil rights movement to women's rights movements, to all the movements that happen, there's a relationship that and that's what movements do. Movements change the nature of the relationship, change the nature of how we deal with each other. But somewhere in that issue, it's the issue of race. It's the issue of race. And what we are willing or what we're not willing to talk about when it comes to race, whether they're people of Asian descent or with African descent or whether they're people of Hispanic descent, wherever it is, we have not been able to deal with the issue of race. So a demagogue, a fascist comes along and begins to tap into that in such a way, in such a way. And yet we have to find ourselves to deal with that. And whether we acknowledge whatever has happened to along our history, all our history has been that. Our history with First Nation people, Native American. We can't even admit that there was a massacre of Native Americans in this. That is not allowed in our public discourse. We have to find ways in which we are able to challenge ourselves and look at ourselves in a different way, wherever we are. And I'm just saying, me as an African descendant, in a way, has had to reorientate myself in the issue of that, and understand wherever we go, we're faced with this challenge.
We have a number of questions here, and I'd like to get through as many of these questions as possible. And I'll ask the panelists if you can be very short in your response and direct in your response so we're able to get through as many questions as possible. The first question is a question I'm going to ask Sandy to respond to, sure. Supervisor Feuer, since you were on the school board. It says, I teach ESL, English as a Second Language, at Jefferson Adult School in Daly City. I've had no guidance from our district. How can I advocate for my immigrant students in anticipation of roundups and or during a roundup?
You know, so thanks for asking that question. I think in San Francisco, as a school board, we have put in some policies to actually protect our students and their families, and we make it very loud and very clear, and we actually articulate that to every student in our school district, that we will stand behind you, you are safe. We do not allow ICE into our schools to question our children. In fact, we are very cautious about having police come into our schools. I think that's another thing we have to be concerned about as a society, is the militarism of our police department, because actually I think that's coming down pretty quickly too in Trump's whole game. But to answer your question, it's amazing as a school board member, and you know, I'm a politician, and so when people come and they advocate on a very simple level in front of your school board and talk about what is needed in particular for your students that you are advocating for, we rarely hear that. I mean, we hear from certain groups about this or that, but when you hear about teachers advocating for their students and actually coming up with a proposal yourself and asking us to sign on to it, that I find that in 99% of the time that the school board is happy to do that, because they also want to protect their students. If they're within a public school entity, they know that their children are at risk. They know that those families that they serve are at risk. We serve the same families, whether it's at Jefferson School District or the San Francisco Unified School District. We know that a lot of our students are undocumented. And also, just to remind you about, in San Francisco, a third of our students come from households where English is not the primary language. And so we know that these needs of English learners are very deep, and English is the gateway language for them to go to college and higher education. And so I would advise this instructor actually to come up with a proposal yourself. What do you think that your students need to be protected? You know your students best. Hear from them and their families, and then bring it to your elected official and ask them to sign on to this and to actually pass it as a policy in your school district.
Thank you. There are two quick questions that I'm actually going to answer. It says, given the complexity of immigration law, would the public defender's office be hiring actual immigration defense attorneys or simply training current criminal assistant public defenders? The answer is that we would hire immigration attorneys. When the Supreme Court ruled about 5 years ago that public defenders had to competently advise their clients as to the consequences of a criminal case, we hired Francisco Ugarte, who is an immigration specialist. And so we've already been in the process of recruiting immigration defense attorneys, because we know we're going to be successful and in making this happen. We have to be. And so if there are any immigration attorneys out there, contact us. The second question is, will funding public defender's office be a more effective investment of resources than going directly to the nonprofit or legal organizations doing immigration law? Why? It's, again, a very good question. I should note that we did not volunteer to undertake representation in these cases. Believe me, we have plenty to do. And instead, we were interested in supporting the nonprofits to do this work. What they said to us after a meeting is that they wanted the Public Defender's Office to handle these cases because of the complexity of these cases, the vulnerability of the clients, and the fact that nonprofits have their hands full with the thousands of other individuals in the community that need this assistance. There are only three nonprofits in San Francisco that provide detention representation. And even with additional funding from the mayor's office, the $1.5 million, they'll be able to do about 60 to 80 cases. And so under our proposal, we would handle up to 600 cases. We're also reaching out to other communities in the Bay Area because the court is regional. So you have people from all over the region who need representation and asking other counties to pitch in. Alameda has already allowed their public defender to hire additional attorneys. So this is something that we're working on
Jeff, can I add
together.
Something too?
Sure.
That when you're dealing with the detained cases, there are a higher percentage of people in those situations who have criminal histories and criminal background. And frankly, as somebody who practiced as immigration law for 10 years before I became a judge, it's gotten even worse now in terms of how complicated the intersection between state criminal law and immigration law is. And the expertise of the Public Defender's Office and people that specialize in crim-im is extremely helpful. And so I can kind of understand the logic of why a lot of the nonprofit groups are saying, we are dealing with a different kind of population of people that generally are recent arrivals that are applying for asylum, for example, that don't have a criminal background. Even within the subspecialty of immigration law, there are these specialties, and so they may feel better suited for that, and that's the unique qualifications of the Public Defender's Office.
Thank you. There's one question here for you, Judge Marks. With the new Attorney General Sessions overseeing the immigration court, is there concern for immigration judges regarding their removal or discipline if they don't support Trump's agenda?
Thank you very much for asking that. That's my union hat in being here, is to educate the public about the need for an independent immigration court and to assure that judges are able to make decisions that they believe are legally correct without ever being at risk of being disciplined or fired for that. We need the structural change. And that's what's extremely important, more so now than ever before. As immigration becomes politicized, the temptation is for there to be pressure applied. And we need the additional safeguards of the independence of an Article I court. So thank you for that question.
Thank you. This is a question from for Beto and Eric. It's actually from a reporter here. We want to thank the media not only for being here, but for the incredible job that they've done covering these issues. Does getting married entitle people to in a relationship to get green cards?
I actually don't know.
Yes, but it's complicated.
Okay, there we go. There's the answer. Yeah, I mean, like, we had the option before. We actually engaged for, like, a year and a half, most 2 years. With the whole process, we don't really know when we're going to get married, but probably soon.
I know.
We're not trying to pressure you. There's a question for Jim. How does the second executive order affect DACA?
I'm told, I haven't found it. I looked all afternoon. I'm told, though, that there's a sort of exclusion for young people.
And explain what DACA is, so people know.
I'm hoping that that's true. There are 23 schools in California, school districts, that have declared themselves sanctuary school districts. So you can imagine that if the kids are undocumented, this administration might go to the schools. And the schools have said no. I suppose the immigration people would wait until the kids got home, probably, and then get them at home. There's also, we should mention, churches that are declaring themselves to be sanctuary mm-hmm. churches. And that goes back to the 15th century. It's a complicated, wonderful, arcane kind of thing. But basically, you get yourself into a church, and the government is afraid to go in there because there might be lightning, they might be struck dead. You don't, depending on how intense your religious beliefs are, you can see where that's a problem. But I also think that where this is going to come a cropper, and you said it exactly, is when it's personalized. It's one thing to sit in the Beltway or in the Trump Tower and imagine a country a certain way. Mm-hmm. It's another thing for people who are grandparents, like myself, to see grandparents taken in a bus and taken out of this country. People, and the stories will just multiply, and how long they've been here. And now we're going to throw them out, and they're of a certain age, and all of that, and whatever trouble they had was so many years ago, and the agent says yes, and they say no, and all that's going to happen, and everything's going to be just fine, and America's going to be great again. It's not going to work. No. It's not going to work. If it's going to work, my romanticized view of the American people is incorrect. And I don't think I'm wrong. We're not going to stand for it. Not just here.
Yeah.
So, not Jim, just here, but around the country. We're not going to stand for it.
Jim, I'd just like people to know the most up-to-date news is the executive order itself does not cover the DACA kids, but there was a memo issued on February 20th by Department of Homeland Security, yes. Kelly, that is withdrawing many other executive orders and policy memorandums from the former administration on various policies, and that is where the authority is, where it is specifically mentioned that the memos on DACA at this point remain unchanged.
I think at this point is key.
Yes.
Because I think if you imagine the man standing next to the president in the White House with his views on race, at this point is the key language. And they'll just keep rolling. We don't want to borrow trouble. We got enough trouble already. But the fact they're not going to do it tonight doesn't mean they're not going to do it. Yeah. In fact, the president, I saw the president, I think this morning, say, only he could put it this way. The idea of putting these kids out is very hard on me. That's what he said. That's what he said. Sorry.
Awesome. All right. Okay, next question is, what other steps can we take to provide until this law is passed? There's a couple of things that's going on. Roberto Hernandez, my good friend, was here earlier to announce that on May 1st, they're going to have a Day Without Immigrant March. It's going to start at 11 a.m. at Justin Herman Plaza, so we can go out and support that. There's also a monthly vigil. One of the audience members writes, at the West County Detention Facility in Richmond every first Saturday at 11 to 12, and it says join us. And also the budget committee hearing is gonna be on Thursday, March 2nd at 10 a.m., so we're trying to get as many people there as possible. Now I know Supervisor Fuhrer, you have another engagement that you have to run off to, but before you leave, can you just tell us, and I'm gonna just read from the card, what other steps, including writing letters, can we take to support the proposed legislation, and can you provide some specifics as to what people should say and who they should write the letters to or emails?
Right, so thank you, Jeff. I think that it's really important to have an internal and external sort of strategy on this, and so looks like I'm the internal strategy, and so the external strategy is really, really important. I think this is what is going to make or break it. So if you could write letters to every one of the 11 Board of Supervisors at the San Francisco Board of Supervisors, because they will have to all vote on this. The Budget Committee will be coming up on March 2nd, as he mentioned, and the people on the Budget Committee are Supervisors Malia Cohen, Supervisor Katie Tang, and Supervisor Norman Yee. I think also letters to the mayor would help, just about how important it is and the urgency of this. And I know that it is unusual to be asking for this money, this supplemental, before we analyze the larger budget for the fiscal year 2017, 2018. However, I think what we heard tonight is that there is a sense of urgency. And so when you write your letters, I'm hoping that you will also express the sense of urgency in how these people are being detained in these prison-like facilities without representation. And again, if we believe in civil rights and if we believe in human rights, which I think San Franciscans really do, then we must believe in due process for all. And I think they just need to be reminded that these are human lives that we're talking about. Many of them, once again, I have to mention that they are the sole providers for their US-born children and also their partners. And so the sense of urgency, the sense of need, the idea that San Francisco should do this, can do this, must do this, I think would be really, really powerful. And I would appreciate all the external support I can get. I think that, you know, it's going to be a bad budget year, we think. We're afraid a little bit about what Trump's going to throw down on us. But quite frankly, I'm afraid for those people that are being detained and that once they are put in a van and deported and over the border, they may never, ever see their loved ones again. And so I think that we have human lives at stake, and so there is a sense of urgency. I have great faith that the decision makers of San Francisco will understand this, but I think with your encouragement and your help, I think they might have a deeper understanding and a deeper commitment the time when it comes to vote for this. So thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, Sandy. Thank you for being here. Next question we have is for Danny. Who is someone who's a non-lawyer? What can they do help promote these programs? How can someone who's not a part of the legal system or a non-lawyer do to promote these programs?
Well, I think certainly we've there's a list of a very imaginative of ways. You can organize in your place of worship. You can organize in your place of work and where you work. There are ways in which, we're gonna have to find extraordinary ways in which we're gonna have to speak out and talk. There's no place for us to be silenced. I like Dante, the hottest places in hell are reserved for those who in a moral crisis maintain their neutrality. There's no place here. There's no place for neutrality here. And where we stand, where we allow our voice to be heard, and the people we engage are and the stories that we embrace, they become our stories. As Jim says, they become our stories. They have to become our stories. And those are the things I'm sure in this audience, and those who have attachments or friends who are not here today can find extraordinary creative ways in which our voice is heard. What we do with our voice is most important. And we can talk about every single thing that we can talk about. What legal strategies, as I said before, but what we do with our voice, how we use our voice, how we create our own space to have our own conversations and create our own narrative. And this is important. We are a country that cannot deal with this history. We have a amnesia in terms of our history and everything else. We have to embrace that history and the truth of that history. It doesn't reflect on what was happening in the past. What we do today reflects on who we can be and where we can go.
Thank you. Just time for just a couple more questions. This is for Jim. Given how complex immigration laws are, what role can generalist lawyers play? In other words, non-immigration attorneys.
I think it's been said they're complex, and I hope I'm not overstating it, but I think that there are many presentations on immigration law by the nonprofits. The Bar Association of San Francisco and other groups are having those. And I think that you can, if you practice for a little while and you've been in courts, right away you can get the substance of it. Asylum, I understand asylum. I get it. And it didn't take that long for me to do it. I'm not an immigration lawyer. So you can get it. The that what hangs over the lawyers is specialization. Now you have to specialize in Zimbabwe debentures. You know, that's what you've always wanted to do, and that's what you do, and there's fear. But I will tell you this. This is my personal experience. You go out there and get the basis, and then you go into some of these places, and you go and meet the people who you're trying to help. There's nothing better in the whole world for a lawyer than that. I really mean it. It's the sanctuary trial that I tried for 6 months, those defendants, Presbyterian minister, a couple of nuns, a priest. And by the way, I asked the nuns why they hit people with rulers, but that's that's beside the point here. Those are some of the best people I ever met in my life. I wouldn't trade those 6 months for anything. And these are the poor, in some cases, the poorest, the most dependent. If there was ever a group that needs lawyers, it's this group. And if you want to feel wanted and you want to be appreciated, then get out there and get what you need to learn, is my answer. Okay?
Okay. So with that, I'd like to thank our panel, and we appreciate all their advice, and comments, and good words. Excuse me. We're gonna close the program, and I'm gonna ask Francisco Ugarte to come up here and talk about what we can do going forward. So I'd ask you to please give a round of applause to Francisco Ugarte. I also wanted to point out that we have many of our partners here. Claire Sullett is here, who is with the Bigglesworth Foundation. We're working with a lot of our partners in the foundation community to provide support as well with our nonprofit partners. I want to thank Tamara Apperton, Larry Roberts, Angela L. Young,
no,
Kathy Asada, and members of the Public Defender's staff
one,
who assisted, and also our interpreters, Noemi Gonzalez and Fanny Suarez. So let's give it up for Francisco.
Another round of applause for this amazing panel.
Great.
So we just have a few more minutes here, and I'd like to close with an experience that I had. In May of 2010, I met a woman named Elizabeth Leigh. Elizabeth Leigh was a teenager and a student at Lowell High School. And in May of 2010, her principal interrupted an exam she was taking. She had a deportation order, along with her brother and her mother. And the principal told her that ICE picked her mother up from her home. ICE agents went to her home, raided her home, picked her mother up. Elizabeth was taken into CPS custody for a week away from her mother. When she was released from custody, they reunited. They didn't have an attorney at the time. They looked for a free lawyer. They found one. I was one of her lawyers, along with Jackie Shull Gonzalez. And Elizabeth Leigh won her case and is now a lawful permanent resident. Elizabeth is here in the audience today. Can you come up? The story doesn't end there. Elizabeth went on to graduate from the University of California, Berkeley, with a bachelor's degree. Oh, excuse me. SF State. Go SF State. she got a master's degree in comparative literature. And this year, she was accepted for admission at the University of California, Berkeley School of Law. And guess what kind of law she's going to practice? Right, she's going to be a deportation defender. She's going to be my boss someday, actually. She speaks three languages fluently. But it's just a testimony to the extraordinary courage that people have today. And it's also a testimony to the fact that when people have an attorney, they can make a difference. So thank you, Elizabeth. Unfortunately, not all stories are like Elizabeth, because there are tens of thousands of people in detention. Most people do not have an attorney. And most of those people waive claims for relief because they don't know that they have those claims. And today, as we've said over and over again, we are trying to change that here in San Francisco by creating the most powerful deportation network in the country. Okay, so we have a few things that we'd like for you to do today to help make this happen. We're circulating letters for you all to sign. Please not only sign a letter, you can drop them off in the back here. Pooja Pascal is collecting letters. You can also ask your friends and your neighbors to do the same thing. And please reach out to Mayor Leigh, Supervisor Sandy Feuer, Supervisor Katie Tang, Supervisor London Breed, and Supervisor Norman Yee, who are all on the Budget Committee. This is an achievable goal, and we can make this happen. Thank you all for coming here today and supporting this program.
Well, thank you again. Thank you to all of you for being here and making a difference. Again, send the emails out. Let people know that this is something that we need to have happen in San Francisco. We'd like to thank SFGovTV and their staff for filming it. Also, City Librarian Luis Herrera and his staff for the wonderful job. And have a good evening.